All right, friends, I'm really sad. What you probably don't realize is that I'm wearing a ton of makeup on my face, like a lot of makeup, that if you saw me in real life without these lights on, I would look vampiric. It's a lot. It's so much. It's so much that I want to turn the lights off and take a picture in normal lighting so you can see how I look like death.
Is there a reason that you haven't done it with the makeup?
V Rising. I was going to do a V Rising bit, but, you know, everybody else here was waiting for me to show up on the call, and I'm sitting here going, holy fuck, these lights are so bright. I'm trying to look more pale. Now I just look kind of shiny.
Somebody tells me you like V-Rising, huh?
I do. Eternal has basically almost beat the game already. He's like 35 hours in.
I'm not surprised.
I knew that you wouldn't be surprised. I knew it. But we've got like 5 or 6 people, and the game has a really unique and interesting progression system. I'm actually deeply impressed with it, and it's... Yeah. I would say it's basically almost finished. I'm very impressed with it as an early access, which makes me wonder what the 2 extra areas that they haven't unlocked yet are going to contain. So we got a community V Rising server, and it's got 4 more spots if you want to join. Grimdark James, thanks for that resub, by the way.
I bought the game, and so normally when I see games come out on Steam, I'm interested in, if they have like a collector's edition or a fan's edition that's more expensive, I'll usually buy that. You know, just, you know, A, to support the game developers, but B, you know, that way I don't have to worry about buying it later. But I looked at V Rising, and I have liked Diablo style clone games in the past, on and off. Like some, you know, like I liked Diablo 2 a lot. I didn't get as much in Diablo 3. I tried, what was the one that everyone was playing recently?
Path of the Exile.
Yeah, that's right. And couldn't get into that one. So I thought, I'm not going to go the whole horn. I'm not going to buy the Founders Pack on V Rising. I'll just buy the standard, which was like 27 Australian dollars. I mean, nothing too expensive. And I played it for like 2 hours and it didn't grab me. Unfortunately, I just, I don't know what it was. It wasn't there for me, but yeah, I'm not begrudging, but I was like it.
Do you hunt any V-Bloods?
No. I got to the point, like it was going to be an obvious significant. I think I got to the point I was trying to build like my castle, the start of my castle, but then the sun came up and I had to just, I couldn't do anything but wait until the sun went down, pretty much.
We can teach you. So, I mean, you got to the boring, shitty part of the game that nobody really likes to do, and you were on the edge of making it to what are essentially like the progression fights. And as you fight each person, when you defeat them and absorb their blood, they teach you new buildings and new abilities. That's the really cool part. Sounds like you just got to the collect stuff. Eventually your castle will protect you from the sun. You just have to make it out of stone instead of wood.
Yeah, no, I found the grind, and there was another game came out this week as well that I've been playing a lot more of, so I was sort of distracted by 2 games.
What's that?
Vampire the Masquerade Swan Song.
Yeah.
Oh, that's actually out now.
Okay. It's out now, yes, although only on Epic Games. So if you're boycotting Epic Games,
I didn't notice it.
That's it. Or an Xbox, sorry. You can get it on console. But for PC,
if you can get it on Xbox, shouldn't you be able to get it through the Windows store?
I haven't even checked, to be honest. Yeah.
I thought that was the whole point of the new Microsoft, was that everything you could get on your Xbox, you can also get on your PC.
Okay. It's just not on Steam, that's all. So.
Yeah, I'm not going to go out of my way to buy it on the Windows store.
I mean, it reminds me a lot of I don't know if anyone's played any of the Quantic Dream games, like Detroit Become Human. You know, it reminds me a lot of that. My only real complaint with it is that the lip syncing is absolutely god awful. So,
Solasta.
Yeah. I mean, like, and that's the thing, is like the body acting is better. Like it's like the actual the movement and the motion capture is really quite good. But then they open their mouths and it's like, yeah, this is like I'm watching something from the early 90s here.
That's okay. So, I don't play D&D for the role play. I play D&D for the murder.
Yeah. There's 2 things that they probably did. They either over engineered it and it looks like shit and they can't justify stepping back, or they're using lip flaps, right? One of the two.
I think without being a game developer myself, I do think it's the latter from what little I know.
Yeah. It reminds, like, lip flaps were great in like Half-Life era games, right? Like, you know, but nowadays you have to, there's a whole thing you need to do in order to get realistic looking faces. Cause it's not just mouths, you know, like it's eyes, it's everything. Like if you can't get that down, it kind of looks weird. Even if like, oh, you're saying an A syllable, so you have to produce this sort of look to your mouth, right? They probably have all that stuff, but then they don't have the rest of the stuff that makes up, like, the face stuff. I haven't seen much of it, but...
So let me peel back the curtain for a second here. At the very start of this campaign, before you joined, David, before you joined Spoon, a couple of times I used a friend of mine who's an actress to record... pre-recorded things that were supposed to be from Pierre's mother. Mm-hmm.
I remember hearing them, yes.
Yeah, and I'd actually, as an experiment at the time, because I do a lot of stuff with like Daz Studio and ZBrush and Blender, that something, I had 3D modeled a picture for Angelique Cowles, and I tried using like the inbuilt Daz function to match lips to speech. So you've got to like type it out using phonetics and such, like type it out in how it would actually sound if you were to type it entirely phonetically, and then it tries to match it, but after like multiple attempts it was just garbage, so I dropped the concept of doing it with a video and just did it as audio. But yeah, I can get why it's really hard to get it right, especially if you're trying to like do a 60-hour game which is all full motion, you know, to get all that dialogue right, because the part I've played so far is almost entirely dialogue.
So the thing about the face stuff is like it's super weird, because like you get a game like Fallout New Vegas, right, and it has the same sort of like visuality of like a modern game. Like it's got 3D backgrounds, you move around, you know, things sort of, you can look at a character's face and they can talk to you, but no one has any issues with how the characters emote in a game like that. But then you get something like, you know, like a Quantic Dream game, and if there's one thing wrong with it, it looks like you notice it and it looks really bad, right? Like
it's Uncanny Valley.
Exactly. It's the Uncanny Valley. But like even then, like it's a vampire game, right? Your brain knows to expect to see stuff that isn't, you know, real, right? Like seeing fangs in people's mouths and stuff like that. Because, you know, if they had actual fangs like here, they would have a weird sound to the way that they talk, but they don't.
Yeah, it adds a lisp. Yeah.
Exactly. But like, so to a degree, your brain should cover that stuff up. But like, if there's anything wrong with it, it just ruins everything. Like, I'm actually working on like just tech for emulating face animations and stuff like that, and we are basically breaking down the systems that they had in the Final Fantasy VII remake and attempting to remake them ourselves, because the stuff they do is insane, like to the point where you can put in any language and the system that they built in that game can emulate like you know, lip sync pretty effectively. But it's most of it's not the mouth, though. It's like when someone, you know, talks, they raise their eyebrows like a slight amount, or like, you know, the eyes never look in the same spot, they're always moving, sort of thing. Or, you know, just like, you know, this part, I don't know what it's called, but like this muscle here, you know, moving, twitching a little bit. Like it's just a bunch of small little things, forehead, like ears moving up and down, like everything. It's crazy. Like if you don't do that stuff, like even just like cartoonishly, it can make your stuff look really weird.
Oh, I mentioned I did a corporate video recently where I was walking towards the camera and they're sort of, you know, talking to the audience style thing. And like after like the fourth or fifth take, they're like, okay, why don't you move your arms while you're talking? Like I'm not a person that talks with my arms, but, you know, some people are. And they said, yeah, for the purposes of like, you know, looking like you're talking to someone who's actively engaged with you rather than to a camera, it does help to have like that arm motion, for example.
Yeah. Also, it takes away the it takes away the focus from your face too much as well, yeah. Which is it's tough. So that's why I always try and do like a stylized approach for games, because if you don't, you can easily fall into uncanny valley even if you don't notice it yourself as a developer. So yeah,
I think if I ever need to develop a game with that sort of level of voice acting, I'll just have everybody wear Bane style masks where you can't see their mouth.
That was like back when I was first getting into Warhammer 40K. Whenever my Space Marines had a head option, it was always the helmet because I didn't want to paint.
My Space Wolves, my first departure from helmets on everything. That's why in Ultramarines don't take the helmets off.
Yep.
Codex approves of this discussion.
Yeah, and I was just like, anytime I try to paint eyes, they're just like big blobby white and black splotches.
Lifeless and dead.
So, Pondo, let's do your intro.
Hi. Yeah, I'm here.
Hi.
I haven't had much to go on as of late. Really just been working. That's about it. I hadn't been able to do any hobby stuff as of late.
You're really not going to like it when I talk to you Monday.
Don't worry about it.
Yeah. We have James Pondo and I have a project we need to wrap up and.
The good news is I got my mirrored turntable so I can actually do the whole. Although it's much bigger than I expected. So.
Okay. All right. I just want to close this project up because they have pretty much indicated that they will not interview with us, and I'm like, I'm baffled why, but you know, whatever. They're the client. Anyway, Pondo, what else do you have when you're not doing anything but working?
Nothing as of late, to be honest. I mean, I did SnowRunner Thursday.
It's true. We finished Ran Simulator on Monday. We still got to pick a new game. You and Cotton have any favorites?
I don't know. I know I was interested in trying out Overcooked. I don't know what she wants to try. And we talked about a few, but I've had a relatively boring week so far.
Okay. You know, speaking of someone who's had a relatively boring week, let's talk to Spoon.
It's pretty true. I have had a fairly boring week. I've just been working, playing Chaos Gate, Demon Hunters.
That game, I forgot about it.
Yeah.
So many games came out at the same time. I feel like I have to complete them at reverse order so I can get back to Battle Brothers.
Yeah. You just gotta work your way back to 2017.
It's 2012, but okay.
Been painting up more BattleTech minis. I'm doing all my light mechs right now because I realized that everything I'd painted so far was like mostly heavies, assaults, and then a few mediums. So I gotta spread out the love. So,
that's what everybody gravitates towards: heavies and mediums.
Yeah, right. Yeah, it's because like I'm still convinced. Like
silence. My boy Dunamis is out here holding it down for us light mech fans.
Like
Pack Hunter represent.
A heavy mech is the epitome, like it's the apex of mechs. Because it's fast enough that you can get where you're going in a reasonable amount of time. It carries enough guns that it can kill whatever's there when it gets there, and enough armor to survive whatever shoots back at it.
I disagree. Maybe a clan because, heavy. Yeah, I was going to say, I feel like that might be true of a Timberwolf, the most perfectly engineered mech of all time, but I hardly think a Jaeger mech is going to stand up against an Atlas.
Yeah, that's because a Jaeger mech isn't really a heavy mech.
It is a heavy mech, by classification. No,
okay. But it's just, not really a heavy mech. Spoon will explain why it's not really
talking,
a heavy mech.
I'm talking like Warhammers, Black Knights.
Is a Warhammer an assault mech? It's 80 tons, right?
Warhammer's no, a heavy.
A Warhammer is 70 tons.
It's only 70 tons.
Yeah,
I'm thinking like, of the 2C.
Okay.
Like, base, and you know, like, a Jaeger mech has it's got its place on the battlefield. That's far, far away from the enemy.
That's it. It's still technically a heavy mech.
Warhammer versus Jordan Page.
They just decided, hey, let's slap a couple.
Yeah, and a cicada is technically a medium. So, you know, what sort of argument do we have in here?
Look at these shit talkers. The cicada is a very effective mech. I don't understand why it gets so much trash talked on.
Honestly, I don't know why either.
Yeah,
there are better medium mechs. No,
it's an alternative version of the Wolfhound.
It's a locust on steroids.
It's good. It's good at hunting light mechs. It can stand up, all right? So it's not going to get taken out by a Jenner with a large laser in one hit.
Yeah.
Yes, it's basically the cheap version of a Wolverine.
Essentially.
The much worse cheap version of a Wolverine. Look, I said it was a good mech. I didn't say it was a great mech.
I love how this conversation that bit started with you defending the cicada and then coming around to be like...
The Wolverine is like a Centurion with jump jets. That's what makes it so good.
Except the Wolverine's faster.
It's like a Centurion with jump jets and is a little faster.
Yeah. See, now I'm a big fan of the Crab. In the medium weight bracket, like
I'm not. I really don't see the hype other than it's just a crab.
I mean, the hype is Rattosaurus cockpit lighting his cigar.
No, it's a 5'8", 16 damage turn mech, which is pretty damn good.
What about Jordan Payne?
The issue is it only has lasers, and it can easily overheat.
16 damage? That's really 20% of a Jordan Payne.
Only if you fire everything. But so you keep them at range, fire the two large lasers.
It only has two large lasers, so it would require you not to move.
One medium, but like...
I mean, it only has 18 heats, not 19, 16 heats.
So you walk and you build up. Like building up one or two heat per round, not that big a deal. See? Oh my God, this guy.
So, how was your week, Spoon?
It was pretty good. It was pretty good.
Are you done talking about that crap, whatever that was? Cool.
Dick's like, oh, Battletech's over? Okay, I'm back then.
He's openly checking his phone just like right up here.
I wanted to make it obvious I wasn't paying attention.
Yeah. No, I
noticed, Dave. Yeah. That's right.
I noticed as well, Dave.
Looking forward to getting Dawn into the gladiator pits, man.
That's not going to happen today.
No, you don't think so?
We're going to spend the whole time stuck in social combat with a bunch of people to get us towards Zagar Ghul.
All right. I don't know. Like in planning tonight, like I there was a point I figured that like if we can get here, this is great. But I also worried if we get there too quickly. If you guys suddenly decide to go like a bullet a gate at the end destination of tonight's episode, we might suddenly go so might cut it short here, guys, because I need some prep time for the next part. But we'll see how we go.
That's fine. Let's do it then. We're just going right up to Zagar Ghul. We're just going to be
fight me, bro.
The Chaos Gate Marines fly out of whatever hole they come out of.
Yeah. Our secret inquisitorial agents teleport onto the battlefield.
Can you even teleport in the webway?
I don't know.
I thought the point was that the webway didn't have a strong connection to the warp, and so you couldn't teleport while you were in it.
Yeah, probably not. You certainly can't teleport into or out of.
Yep.
I got two experts here, and I've stumped both of them with a really casual comment. They're like, "Oh, I don't know if that's true." Now,
so here's the thing, though: if the place you're teleporting from is already in the webway, can you then teleport to somewhere else in the webway?
Yeah, but when you teleport, you go through the warp.
That's what I'm saying.
Okay.
because this place isn't connected to the warp, I thought intrinsically it would not be able to teleport. But now we have no indication that that's true, because no one in the canon has apparently stopped and said, wow, it'd be really easy as Eldar to just teleport using our psychic powers through the webway, an already shortened path. Maybe that's the key behind the Harlequins. Maybe that's the key to their success. They just teleport everywhere.
I believe
this sounds like something Magnus and Red would say.
The Harlequins are just like, we know the secret pass, but really they're just like, all right, so if I go from point A to point B, I can transfer 200 billion light years. All right, Dave, what do you got? Sorry, we can't talk about your intro because you're under contract. Yeah! Go ahead.
Okay. You worked on that.
Oh, boy.
So, yeah, I mean, I released a demo for my game under contract. Arthur played it. It was great to watch him suffer.
I did suffer. I will not play it again. I think I ended by saying I would finish another hour of it, but I'm not going to. I think it's a fine game if you're into that kind of content. It's exactly what you're looking for. It was not what I was looking for. It's also too hard for me.
Yeah.
I was beating stages and I was just like, I don't know how I'm winning.
It's relatively simple, to be honest.
Yeah. It's not that simple.
It is.
This exact discussion is the divide of that game, because people either get it or they fucking don't get it.
I don't get it. I'm sorry.
It was only harder because you're using two hands, Arthur.
So it would be easier with one hand? That's your supposition, James?
I get the joke.
I feel like the joke should have been the opposite, though.
Yeah, the control scene it makes you have to use both hands. That's the problem.
Oh my god.
So I mean,
Grammy strength.
Like, we've gotten a lot of feedback. Like, if we made it like how we originally wanted to make it, it would kick everyone's ass. So to put in perspective, the AI in the game is at 0.1, sorry. Because normally when we were playing the game, like, we'll set it to 6 or something, right? And for anyone who's played Magical Drop or Money and Puzzle Exchanger before, it's like, yeah, cool, got it, easy peasy, let's go. But literally anyone else who plays the game is just like, man, I am getting fucking worked out there. So you remember the very first tutorial fight we had against the blue-haired demon in the game? We had so many people come back to me and be like, yeah, I can't beat this bitch. I can't do it. I can't beat him. And it's like, I don't understand. We can't make it any easier. The only way that we can make it easier is by literally making them only move, like, because normally they move, like, you know, once a second sort of thing. And we're like, okay, what if we make it so that they only move once every 3 seconds? And then people will come back and they'll be like, still too hard. What is happening? And I was like, oh God, okay. So we've got to really dumb this shit down.
You're making me feel really bad.
Yeah. Arthur, if you were struggling at that difficulty, man, like... So the game is based on an old Nat Geo game called Magical Drop. And it was literally like a quarter-destroying arcade machine back in the day. And there are so many people out there that are just like, oh, I fucking love this game so much. I spent so much money on this fucking game. So we're like, okay, let's make a fucking game out of it. And anyone who's played those games before is just like, yes, thank you. But anyone else who hasn't played, it's just like, I don't get it. Or like, this game is too hard. It's this weird max. But yes, we are going to add a hard mode in there, because people like Pondo who get it, even if they haven't played the original game.
Part of my struggle is my keyboard, because I have a cheap keyboard till I can replace it eventually.
Yeah.
Pondo, did you record and stream it for all of us to watch you do all the voices?
No, I was watching my kid all day, so I didn't really have.
Mm-hmm.
I won't find it even the voices.
It's literally 50 minutes long, Arthur. And you played the game.
I played over 50 minutes of it. How could it only be 50 minutes long?
I don't know what to tell you.
Unbelievable.
You skimmed through the wording, essentially. That's what I did. I skimmed through all the dialogue. Like,
I mean, even when I was reading it, like, at normal pace, like, in my head, I guess. If you're reading it out loud, it's probably longer, I guess. Because, you know, streamers. The game is fun. We're going to add a lot more content to it. Like, that's just a demo. It's just, like, a small little area, so... Each department will roughly take like maybe 3 hours to get through the entire thing. We'll see. Like, basically, we're aiming for like 8 to 10 hours for a full finish of the game.
Yeah, the season pass, loot boxes.
Mm-hmm.
Prize boxes, mechanics. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. You guys are under it. So we have a Kickstarter going for it right now. Kickstarters are hard, man. Holy shit. Like, so hard. You literally have to like if we were selling the game as normal sales, we'd be like, fuck yeah, that's an awesome amount of sales for one day. But for Kickstarter, it's like, we could be doing more. You know what I mean? Like, it's definitely interesting, but we'll see. I think we'll do okay. I think we'll just get over the line, maybe. With the current pace, so gonna be trying to do some.
Is that why you're hyped today? Why you're full of energy?
No, the reason I'm hyped today is because I got really good news about a home loan evaluation. So, yeah. And in this market,
terrible. This economy?
Yeah. This economy? Forget about it.
Oh man, But here's the thing, if we don't buy a house now and we go, oh, we'll just wait for a better market, that better market will probably never come, right? Like, it only seems to be getting more and more expensive. So, I mean,
did you see that the people who kicked off the GameStop crisis finally cashed in their chips today? They're donezo. Melvin Capital?
No.
Oh.
Oh, they survived it then.
No, they're done.
Oh, they're done. Okay. They're
shutting down.
So just so you understand how gigabrain these people are, they shorted a bunch of positions and then publicly posted what their shorts were. Someone was just like, hey, these guys shorted GameStop. What a bunch of idiots. I'm going to buy a shit ton of GameStop stock. Oh, my God.
I mean, normally it works the other way. If you are a respected investment firm and you say, sell this stock, people will sell that stock.
Yeah, well,
it didn't work. GameStop play price, stupid games, skyrocket.
Look, spite is a powerful motivator.
Well, I mean, GameStop used that money to leverage a new CEO and NFT division and completely revitalize their entire... They finally moved to an online digital store, right? Like...
I mean, that was happening.
It wasn't happening fast enough, and their stock was plummeting at the time. And someone was just like, Melvin Capital.
Yeah, so like
we got GameStop, but we had to suck dry the husk of Melvin Capital to do it.
Literally, like 4 months before the huge spike in GameStop stock was like $4.30. The reason I know this is because I looked at it and I went, should I buy some GameStops? It's really cheap right now. And I'm like, no, there's no way it'll ever come back. It's like GameStop's fucking dead. It's and then like
buy it at $4, sell it at $2.80.
4 months later, the stock was like $400. And I went, boy, I wish I would have bought some.
Yeah, but if you did buy it, right? Would you have checked out early when it went down before it went up?
I mean, I probably would have checked out around $200 like per share and just been like, sweet, this is a...
The other thing is that from an investor perspective, an investor couldn't have predicted the market no factor way. That drove that up. Like it was purely, it was like, you know, it was spiked through Reddit. It was nothing to do with the
hashtag diamond hands.
Well, yeah. Let's be clear here. GameStop was definitely undervalued. It's just not worth
not $200. Yeah, exactly. Like I would say, like, it's probably pretty solid at like the $75 to $100 range where it's at right now.
These are people whose primary business is buying something back from you for $5 and selling it for $60. That's a pretty good business model.
Well, and like their new CEO was it Chewy is the online like pet company? I don't know. But anyway, he has a lot of experience previously with online businesses and turning them around. So, but anyway, this is not financial advice.
Okay, stop Reddit memeing.
Yeah.
The other thing I did today, I released Odyssey Tactics on Itch as well. Download that for free. And that one is more like a prototype game. It's mostly just like to prove that we've made this thing, and you know, we're gonna go forward and continue making it. But Arthur didn't like it, apparently.
What? I did not like it. I just didn't really know how to play it.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I mean, there's no.
I wasn't against it in any way. I just didn't really. There's no tutorial, so.
Yeah, no direction.
I had to figure out that you use spacebar to skip characters because there's no indication that that's how you do it. I was trying to jump and I was like, oh, I'm a new character. What just happened? Did I die from hitting spacebar? I'm over there.
That sort of stuff is like, you know, when it comes to GUI and user feedback, user experience and flow, that sort of shit's not in the game right now. It's mostly just proving a gameplay loop. And honestly, I think it works pretty well right now. Like, I want to add a lot more like for the characters to do, because the goal is that they're supposed to feel like heroes. And right now, there's just they don't have enough power to like combat like large amounts of enemies. Even the best players can get to like wave 4 before they just get completely overwhelmed, mostly because there's just no way that you can take out all of the enemies that you're supposed to take out in this game. But, you know, it's mostly just like a stress test of the gameplay loop. So we figured we'd put it out.
And are you going to buy Fire Emblem Three Hopes?
Yeah. That's the Fire Emblem Dynasty Warriors game?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Oh,
yeah,
is
really interesting.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's obviously the same setting as Three Houses, but it's just, yeah, the Dynasty Warriors style.
I already read. Listen, I've. 2 out of 3 storylines, I've raised those kids from precocious little shits to hardened super warriors who are all in love with each other. Okay? I don't need to watch them kill each other a third time. I've already done it 2.5 times. I gotta finish my Blue Lions.
Or you could just do a Spoonic playthrough and just let everyone kill each other constantly.
Yeah, I was surprised he was actually able to finish the game given that everyone was dead.
That surprised me so much when I heard him. Just like, yeah, I lost a couple of characters on the first mission, and you know, and I'm just like,
it's like playing Final Fantasy Tactics. So you're just like, you lost who? Orlando? I didn't even know that was possible.
I got a lot going on at the moment.
All right. You got anything else you want to share?
My kid has started squawking, which is nice.
Did you say scorping?
Squawking. Squawk.
Like squawking. Making like, noise?
Yeah, like goo goo garring all the time and all that sort of shit. And if vocalizing, you see me with a couple of bald patches in my beard, you know what's happened. She's basically like grabbing it and just going right now, and it's like, okay. Yeah, it's nice, and everyone I talk to is like, oh, you blink and it'll be gone. I'm just like, I don't know about that. Like, she's Yeah, she's growing quickly, but like I don't think it'll be like something that I'll miss. So I don't know, maybe it's different for me because I'm constantly at home. So
yeah.
Maybe it'd be different now if I was going in the office for like 8 hours every day, coming back and not seeing them and stuff. So anyway, yeah. I'm here to shoot a spaceman with a sword.
All right. I'll do my intro now. I beat Suikoden in a day.
Connor Hughes.
Next, I opened by talking about my makeup for V Rising, and that evolved, but that wasn't actually my intro. It will be short, however. I beat Suikoden. In the next week or two, Connor Hughes and I are going to be starting on Tales of Destiny 2, also known as Tales of Eternity in the United States. And
what is Suikoden? I've never heard of this one.
Suikoden? It was like Konami's attempt to make a multi-game series. Like, a bunch of the characters at the end of Suikoden are like, you know, I joined you at the last minute, and I'm a powerful warrior with a tragic backstory. If only you knew more, watch me walk off into the sunset. Suikoden 2! Peshmerga returns! And I'm just like, yeah, that guy, I never even added him to my party. I know nothing about him. I don't give a shit. So they tried to set up this narrative of, like, there were going to be a bunch of Suikoden games, and characters from earlier games would resolve their shit down the line. It didn't work out because, of course, Konami was just like, I don't know. But you get 3 Suikoden games, and that's it. But the guys who made it are the ones that funded 100 Heroes of Yuden Chronicles, the Kickstarter game, and it basically has the same premise. There's 100 different heroes you have to recruit to bring together in your base, and then you overthrow an empire, probably. I don't know. We don't know that much about it. It's one that has the giant demi-human kangaroo.
That just makes me think of the Prosy D sketch where you are going to fight this guy, and the archer is like, yeah, you know, my brother, take me with you, and like, no, you suck, dude. We haven't leveled you at all.
That reminds me of Shadowrun Dragonfall, where a dude was like, take me on this mission, my brother's there. And I was like, I don't really like you. And I just fucking killed his brother. When I got back to base, he's like, I can't leave, but I hate you now. And I was like, I don't care. I never liked you anyway. That was part of the reason I felt Dragonfall was the worst fucking game, was because all of the heroes were deeply unlikable.
Wasn't Dragonfall the first one, though?
No,
Shadowrun Returns.
Yeah, no, I like Dragonfall, though. I haven't finished the Hong Kong one. But
Hong Kong was top shit, man. Everybody in that game is great. Hong
Kong was good.
Yeah,
Hong Kong was excellent.
Wait, I thought Dragonfall was the Hong Kong one.
No.
Returns, so Dragonfall, Shadowrun.
Yeah, Returns was the Seattle Slasher storyline. Mm-hmm. And then Dragonfall was the one in Germany. And then, yeah, Hong Kong is the most recent one.
It's been a while, though. Hong Kong's got to be like 5+ years old.
Oh my god, don't fucking say that. I remember when those games came out.
Yeah, it came out about the same time as the last Battle Brothers expansion. Meanwhile, James, what do you got going on?
Look, I've been traveling this week. I did a few days in Melbourne, a few days in Brisbane for work, doing trade shows. So, I had like the most amazing hotel Wi-Fi in the hotel in Brisbane. Like, as I say, I managed to download like a 20 gigabyte game in like 10 minutes. It was impressive. So that allowed me to play some Swan Song in the hotel. I've installed it on my home machine since getting back, but haven't had a chance to play it again yet. So I would like to get some more of that done. Still working on painting my Death Guard kill team. I think I said last week that the store that I discovered in Sydney that I've been going to suddenly announced they're closing down, but they are still they're finishing their painting competition, so doing my kill team for that. Probably not a lot else, really. I played Ticket to Ride with my family yesterday. That was fun. I came last. yeah,
like the original board.
You're on mute, Arthur.
I said, really? Is this a thing where dads go easy and let the kids win?
No, I just got terrible options. But this is the junior edition. Yeah, so it's a bit easier on the kids. Effectively, the rules are the same. It's just the paths are shorter. You've got like one train paths and two train paths. I just got terrible options, and the routes got closed off to me before I had a chance to claim them. So, the kids had a good time. That's really it. There was a federal election here yesterday. We've changed governments. Spent up last night watching the election coverage. Who's the guy on CNN who does all like the board with Wolf all Blitzer. The we've got the same sort of guy here, a guy named Anthony Green, who, you know, we were like up until 3 a.m. watching his analysis of, you know, this one's, you know, we're 50.1 here, so we can't quite award that one yet. But if the numbers pan out, then we think we'll get to 50.3. So, it's always fun. And you know, the team I wanted won, so feels good too.
Wolf Blitzer.
I wanted one as well.
I deeply considered naming a Solaris Gladiator Wolf Blitzer because it sounds like
a gladiator.
It sounds like an American gladiator name that would fit in with Blaze, Laser, Inferno, Magma, Jade.
I could see him fighting on the pyramid.
No.
But I don't remember that show, but I remember that fucking pyramid. Oh my god, I remember that pyramid.
So much of Solaris Knights was inspired by American Gladiator. If only Zillia, the most electrifying man in sports entertainment, was still here with us.
Wrong clanner.
Do you guys have like a portion of the game show where like two mechs stand on a pole and have to like punch each other until the person falls off?
That's Rock'em Sock'em Robots.
Yeah. They had that in Gladiator where they stood on the pole and they had
That was basically the main competition, was that particular.
Well, no, and then there was the thing where you had to run across into the different stations and shoot the target above the gladiator's head, and
what the show was known for.
Sure.
No, it was the pyramid is what it was known for.
I mean, like I remember when I was first getting into BattleTech, the film Robot Jocks came out, which was like, you know, for us, it's like BattleTech fans, and it's like, great, this is like a BattleTech-esque movie, and you watch it now, and it's so, so bad.
Yes, it is.
You guys had to live through the BattleTech TV series, which I thought was great as a kid, and as an adult, I wonder how it got produced at all.
So,
I was already a teenager by the time that came out, so...
It's bad.
I didn't know it at the time, but I actually had the Adam Steiner Axeman toy as a kid. No idea what it was from. It was just a robot that was cool.
It was so bad.
Yeah. I mean, look, hey, I was in the Robotech before I was in the BattleTech, so you know, saw the first MechWarrior book. It's like, oh, these are Robotech mech. This is a different setting.
Why are they calling it a Stinger?
Yeah, where's Rick Hunter and Roy Foker and all the.
Yeah.
Why hasn't anyone been slapped lately?
Why hasn't anyone turned into an airplane?
That's right. Yeah, why aren't they solving their problems with love?
Put on a concert for the Claners.
Oh, man.
Anime.
That's all I got, I think. So I don't know. You want to clip it now?
Oh, it's already clipped.
It's already clipped. Okay. No worries. Yeah. All right, well, I've opened the wrong file. Give me a second, I need to reopen the recap file.
I'll extend the clip, don't worry about it. Meanwhile, let's talk about today's sponsor,
I'm ready.
Water. You need, go ahead.
Sorry, sponsor. Go sponsor something else. Previously on Rogue Trader, Strings of Fate, entering the streets of the Nexus of Shadows, the group makes their way to the home of Dirac Nir, a Dukari noble that may be able to help them find their way in the alien city. Dirac Nir seems eager to help the group, if only for the social status it will give him to be associated with the Monkei everyone are talking about. He offers them rooms in his home, as well as an invitation to an event at Zergarn Kul Ziggurat. Speaking of one of Nir's servants, the group discovers that she is an Eldar captive and a former disciple of Talon Balwing. The group organizes to use the girl to run messages to Balwing in the Shadowspine Pits. A few days later, the group attends the Dukari noble party being run at Kul Ziggurat. They discover games of debauchery where slaves are thrown into death matches for the enjoyment of those present. As the group ponders its next move, Sister Dawn is approached by the succubus Aniawa. Thought for the day, study the alien, the better to kill it.
What about me being approached? That's interesting.
Yeah.
Is it like Dio style? Like,
sorry?
You've detected an enemy stand user. Dawn is just like, huh? You're approaching me?
God. That was, yeah.
Muda.
Obscure reference.
Yeah, JoJo references.
JoJo isn't really that obscure. It is terrible, anymore. But it's not obscure.
I didn't know it.
You're so much better off.
Is it anime?
Yep.
It is. I want you to imagine an anime where the Nazis are on the side of the good guys and beating a cat is normal. So fucking weird.
Two of the lesser weird concepts I've seen in anime.
It originally started off as Jim Carrey's The Mask, and then it turned into a vampire story, and then it turned into a bloodline story, and then it turned into craziness, and then it turned into the pyramids, and then
Jim Carrey's The Mask was the first DVD I ever bought. True story.
Wow. Well,
then you basically know the plot of you know, JoJo's Bizarre
Adventure. Dio shows up. So. He's just like, somebody, stop me.
Yeah, it was back when, like, whether it was like a Sony release or a MGM or Warner Brothers release, they were different size packages, and so like I ended up throwing out because it was like the one DVD I had that didn't fit with the rest of the DVDs on my shelf, because whatever the other style was is what won out. So the OCD and me won out in that respect.
Betamax sends its regards.
Exactly. Thank porn for that.
Oh, welcome.
All right. So, speaking of porn, this scantily clad succubus is approaching you, Dawn. Clearly with intent of talking to you. Do you need the picture again, or you're okay?
Yeah, I'm okay. Succubus.
Oh, there you go. Publish again. There we go. Okay. But once again, not
oh, yeah, wait, hang on. I got to get in a roll 20.
Oh, that's true. You know, roll 20, so you cast the picture. Yeah.
Got him.
Yeah.
I'm going to be honest with you, bro. I would not consider that to be scantily clad. It's showing less skin than the standard swimsuit. I mean...
Populate that shit again for me.
I mean, compared to your average...
I'll look respectfully.
Sister Battle Nun, yeah. I would say that's pretty scantily clad.
Yeah. I mean,
like...
Is that the standard we're using? Full body power armor?
Look, there's... Info
with helmet?
In this 40K, is perspective of Dawn, okay?
Okay, all right.
So in 40K, there is using your imagination, and then this just leaves nothing to the imagination. You're like, okay.
I get it. I was just like, I can see both her calf and the back of her neck. Heresy.
Why do you have the midriff exposed for like two abs and then covered up for the rest? Like, it makes no sense.
Yeah. Well, they do dodging. They don't really necessarily have armor.
I think that's true. I think they actually have. I don't think what she's wearing counts as armor. I know it does. Sorry, no, it's got 2 points of armor. There you go.
It'll help protect against a paper cut.
Yeah, so. Including on the head apparently, which should cover the head, even though, you know.
So remind me, we're at the party, yeah.
Yeah, you're on a balcony at the ziggurat. We're overlooking a Death World garden where slaves are being...
where they're doing the slave thing. Yeah,
that's right, yeah.
Okay. So she approaches me.
Yeah, she approaches you, yes. I hear you're looking to fight the arena champion. This news has gotten around the Nexus.
Yeah, well, what can I say? I'm bored and looking for something to do.
She rolls her eyes at that. What makes you think that just because you're bored, you can step in as a top contender?
I'm literally a living saint. As far as I'm concerned, there is no cues that needs to stop me.
Don't know or don't care what a living saint is. There are systems here. My champion has competed to rise through the ranks to become the number one contender to fight Talon Baelwin. You can't just walk into the arena and expect to to move into top contentious spot.
So why are you approaching me then, if there's no problem?
I'm trying to find a measure of why you seek this. I admit I'm disappointed that boredom is your only reason.
Wow. Normally, when it comes to these sorts of things, I don't have to worry about too much. The boredom part of it comes from the fact that for a blood sport, you're putting in a whole lot of red tape.
This is not just a sport. There is a lot tied to this, a lot of status, a lot of power in this city. Cool's champion winning in the arena gives him, the arena is mine. My cult has always owned the Shadow Spine pits. But Cool has influence because his champion has the reins. It's not simply for sport or for entertainment that these fights take place. Deals are struck over the results of these encounters.
Okay, here's the thing. If I fight, I win. That's all there is to it. You can profit from that if you want. It doesn't bother me in the slightest. I only wish to fight the champion.
And then after you've won, what then? You'll stay and defend your title?
If it's interesting. Where I go is the whim of the God Emperor. After all, I am his messenger and the closest arm that he has.
What if I could give you legitimacy to compete that you want?
But sounds you have a butt coming up.
Well, you would compete in my name so that you would be my champion against Cools.
Remind me, James, where was Talon Baling in all of this mess?
So he's the current champion, and he is a possession of Zagar Cool, the bad guy. Mm-hmm. You're all bad.
Okay, and in this deal, I would be fighting Zagar Cool.
No, you'd be fighting Talon Baling. But the idea is that if you win, like she's implying that you would be her champion, so therefore she gets the kudos for the victory.
The terminology, the way that you say these things is kind of unnerving to me, given everything that you are. However, I will fight on behalf of your house. I am not your personal champion. I don't think I'll ever will be your personal champion. There's nothing in these solar systems that will ever make me your anything. I want to point that out.
But she thinks,
if this is what it's going to be for me to get into the ring and prove my worth, absolutely. We can come to some agreement.
Your worth is as yet completely unproven. For this to work, you would need to first defeat my champion to prove that you're a better contender than she is.
Okay, bring her out. I'll cut her head off right in front of you right now.
Stay here. Let me go and make some arrangements. She walks off. All right. So for the rest of you, actually, Arthur, are you currently... So are your psychic senses on or not?
Yes.
Okay. Could I have a Sinisian's test at minus 10?
Okay. Sinisian's minus 10. That's great because my Sinisian's isn't that good. It's a coin flip here.
All right, but look, there you go. You did it. Yeah. Okay. So, while you're in this ziggurat, there is definitely some sort of background psychic noise, like a sort of psychic static. You can't quite sense where it's coming from. It's pervasive. It sort of comes from the building itself. But you notice as you're sort of not watching, you're probably choosing not to watch the blood games taking place in the gardens, but anytime one of the human slaves dies in the gardens, you sort of get this weird psychic twinge, like similar to what you felt when you tried to communicate with Balwin directly, drawing force. And you feel the soul of that person at the moment of their death being drawn into something inside this ziggurat. There's like some sort of all pervasive psychic force which is drawing in the souls of the dead as they pass.
Okay. If I wanted to know more, I of course have all regular knowledges. Yep. And then forbidden lore, psychers, warp, and occult. Is there anything that would help me discover more?
Well, give me a warp, forbidden lore warp roll.
The I'll
give
one you that plus I 10. Am worst at.
Okay.
Of course.
I will re-roll that.
Okay.
With a fate.
All right.
Nope.
Okay. Would you also just roll me a d10, please?
Sure. See how many fate points I lose here?
No. Okay. So, in fact, you spent the fate point, but the re-roll didn't count, even though it was still a failure.
Wow. Okay. So I'm finishing up my conversation with whoever I'm talking to.
Yeah.
Now, hold on a sec. I said before coming to the party, I'm wearing like my least threatening clothing possible to look the most threatening.
Okay.
And only carrying my Wraithblade, but I am armoring myself with the Psyker skill that I have.
Yes.
That allows. Has that been affected by entering this place?
Probably, did I feel it
like lessen or completely die out?
No, so I'll say that it's still in effect, but you feel like the concentration required to maintain it, even though it has no game effect of concentration. Effectively, it's something that's drawing on the psychic power, and it takes more concentration to hold it up.
All right, so my face is cringing with distaste because, of course, I'm talking to a dark elder, and looking at them for me is like looking at someone who isn't there. It is instead like bathed in the tormented blood of humans. Right. And I just go, servants, you know, they always serve their captain and they're stepping in. They talk in his regard. They just keep messing things up. We picked up this new servant. She's terrible. Anyway, great party. So nice talking to you. And then I move over to stand next to Pierre.
Okay. All right.
All right. And the joke was missed. It's fine.
So a new figure emerges at the party. It's a male Drakari. He has four physical arms, like four arms on his body, but he also has like a Dr. Octopus style back brace of cyber mechanical limbs that are like octopus coils ending with various blades or surgical implements that effectively he walks on. So it holds his body up in the air by his back as like the lower sort of limbs carry him aloft, and the other sort of limbs above him sort of snake about almost with a mind of their own. He has like his skin is sort of very leathery, whereas most of like the Drakari here are sort of like never seen the sun before vampire tans. This guy's skin is like almost tanned, and you know how you go like if you spend a lot of time in the sun, like think of Hulk Hogan in like the early 90s, where he's like, you know, his skin was like natural leather almost from just constant tanning and age.
I don't know if you've seen it, but I'm thinking Dog the Bounty Hunter vibes here.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Because his skin is like leather.
Dog the Bounty Hunter.
Yeah, but he had a beard, didn't he, as well? Dog the Bounty Hunter?
He did. Don't worry about it.
On and off.
Yeah, no. So, yeah, so no beard, but the same, you know, luxurious long hair, though, as well. So,
I lean in next to Pierre and I say, Lord Captain, I believe that maybe Zagarkul. At the very least, you should be aware that this temple, the Ziggurat, is emitting a interference with the warp, and it is consuming the souls of those who die here.
Interesting.
Do you need anything from me?
Not at the moment.
All right, I'm going to go back over there and glare at some people. You should try the canapé.
Love the idea that Dawn walks over to fucking the Lord Captain. It's like, I need you to arrange to get my armor sent down here. I'm going to have a fight with some succubus lady or something. I don't know.
I left you alone for 5 minutes. What happened?
Look, I'm getting us into the grounds, the combat grounds, like you wanted.
That's so near of you. Doing it
the fast way. Well.
Very well, Cynical.
Thank you.
This figure heads over towards you, Pondo. As he gets close, like his cybernetic limbs lower him down, so he's not standing on the ground. Like his toes are just off the ground, and he's maintaining so he's slightly taller than you. Because standing naturally, he would probably be a little bit shorter, but he does maintain that sort of slight height advantage. You must be Lord Commodore Pierre Cowles of the Hand of Calixus. Am I correct?
You are indeed correct, and would I have pleasure of meeting you now?
I am Dracaris, the homunculus of the Sutured Helix Coven, yes, and Arch Agonizer of Savoim.
It's a very lovely title you have there, then.
Sorry, Agonist, Arch Agonist, sorry. I am the humble servant of Zagarkul, his vizier, you might say. Unfortunately, Kul can't join us this evening, but he asked me to extend his welcome to his household. I take it that the Drakari of the city have been welcoming to you and your crew.
More so than I'm used to, I should say.
You right, Alpha?
Sorry. I imagine that they look at us like we're hunks of meat and they're ravenous wolves, but sure.
I mean, this guy probably is looking at me essentially like that, yeah.
He's sizing you up from above you and licking his chops.
I think he wants to turn me into a grotesque? Is this the guy that does that?
They do create grotesques, yes.
Okay, yeah. So yeah, he's looking at me a piece of meat that he could turn into something horrible.
So is Dawn still there? Dawn walked away from this conversation.
I'll still be there.
Okay. And you must be Sister Dawn Britannia, living saint, yes? Am I correct?
That is correct.
You know, I'm something of a living saint myself.
Okay, James, you gotta calm down.
That's what he says. It's,
I'm sure he does.
In a different way, I suppose, but perhaps very similar.
Did you watch Spider-Man recently and you just...
No, I have watched Spider-Man, but not recently, but I do get the reference to the whole, I'm something of a scientist myself. But,
yeah.
Well... Sure. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Well, from what I understand, we are both long-lived. We are both not as delayed by death as it would seem for others. Given powers by our faith. Well, whatever faith really is.
There is only really one faith. Everything else is imitation.
I was hoping that that you would come to this gathering. When I heard about your arrival, I thought to give you a gift. And like one of his limbs reaches around behind his back and pulls out of like a satchel hanging from his belt a rather battered looking book So the book itself is like bound leather tome with like a chain wrapped around it and a padlock that looks like it's been damaged to the point that you can just open the padlock by hand now. It doesn't properly lock itself anymore. But he extends the book. Well, his subject leave extends the book to you as an offer.
And what do I owe this gratuity for?
This is purely hospitality. I offer this to you with no expectation of recompense.
Might I ask what it is?
It's an illuminated tome, something one of your faithful, one of the many martyrs of your church has written in the past.
Okay. Dawn will take it.
Okay. No worries.
Limb, I guess. Yep. And
yeah, that's fine. So I'll look, give me a common law ecclesiarchy role. Or Imperial Creed.
I have
an old tome from Lorgar.
Imperial Creed is better.
Yep, that's fine.
I don't think I have either.
I know a guy who's got some knowledge.
Is that a success? I can't tell.
It is.
Okay, no worries. So what he's given you is actually a very rare tome. Well, it's, when I say it's rare tome, it's one of a kind. So it is the personal writings of Saint Arret the Lethicant, a saint who was from the Calixta sector and disappeared in battle hundreds of years ago. It's, you know, his works are assumed to be lost at his death, but apparently this is his tome and is in not great condition, but still readable. You know, as the writings of a saint, this in itself is a relic of the church.
Do I have scholastic law Imperial Creed as well? Do you want me to roll on that, or like it's the same, exactly the same roll that I just rolled? So,
okay. So I mean, you're familiar with Lethicant's, with Arret the Lethicant's writing. I mean, scholastic law will tell you more from a education perspective about him, right. But it doesn't really change the fact that this in itself is a very valuable work that the church would definitely want to have its hands on.
Now, can we scan it to be turned into PDF?
I mean, it's all handwritten, you know, by the saint himself, so.
If there's anything like other stuff, it would probably be written on the dried skin of his flesh. Some shit like that.
I've read this tome cover to cover. I admit I find your faith very interesting from a purely academic point of view, of course. I hope this will...
Thank you very much for returning it to us.
I didn't take it. I came across it in
I wasn't the implying past. The idea that books eventually return to their sources very important. So thank you.
Yes. Now, while I make that offer without any expectation of return, I had hoped that now that the proverbial ice is broken, whether we could potentially broker an additional trade.
Trading is not really my forte. That is what the Lord Captain here is.
I think Pierre at this point is just slowly like getting in front of Dawn.
You're doing the Thor thing.
I don't think Pierre has the guts to do like the physical like hand to the face. He just politely kind of just starts getting to the front of this conversation.
Okay, yeah. All right. Seeing this, he turns straight back to Pierre. I apologize, Lord Commodore Pierre Cowles of the Hand of Calixus. I didn't mean to exclude you from this conversation. It was more a case of Sister Dawn Latenya, the living saint here, has what it is I'm looking to purchase. I, of course, wouldn't ever presume to ask you to sell her. Well, I suppose by saying that, I've sort of indicated that if she were for sale, I would buy her. But assuming that she is not something that you're selling, I perhaps wonder if I could buy something of hers. And I will admit what I've brought in trade is probably more of interest to her than it is to you. But you are a man of business, so if you are who I should conduct trade with, then let us begin the bargaining.
I mean, if it's possession of hers, I can't really say what it's... I just have to know what you're asking for.
Ah, yes, well...
To be able to find some sort of worth.
I'm quite interested in what a Monkey living saint actually is, so I was simply hoping for one pint of her vitae, of her blood, that I may study it and learn more about the nature of her condition.
A whole pint of blood?
Yes. I've taken that you humans have around 9 to 10 pints in your body any time on average. It shouldn't cause any significant loss in...
A whole pint, yes. Yes, it does. Actually, you can pass out after losing about 2 pints, but that's besides the point.
I don't need 2 pints.
Fuck you, Spoon.
What do you do? Oh, okay. I see what you did there. Okay. All right. And what are you planning to offer for such holy blood?
Well, I tried to think of what someone like Sister Dawn Latania, the living saint, would actually like, and I went to my collection of artifacts, and I happened to have a vessel made of powdered bone which contains the distilled essence of 1,000 imperial martyrs, separated from their eternal reward by their soul reaving, whereas such a relic could prove a great power source for Dukhari. I would feel that an imperial saint or any member of the human ecclesiarchy would like to release these souls so that they can return to your god emperor.
Obviously, we would have to release that souls away from the harvester, correct?
Sorry?
We'd have to release those souls away from the harvester, correct?
From the harvester? I'm not sure.
I'm sorry. The, what's it called? Soul care? No. I feel like I'm mixing.
Okay, so I'm gonna time out here and remind you that
I don't know
so
about it, do I?
So you know about the Soul Reaver, but okay. The only Drakari that know about it are Zagar Kul and Slain Morn.
Oh, okay. Then yeah. Belay that then. Never mind.
Okay, no worries.
So, okay, the depth of my knowledge of the ecclesiarchy is quite limited, I will say. Yeah. So, in terms of, like, this relic, this soul device, the powdered bone, or whatever it is that he mentioned.
Yeah, so this is not a human relic. It's the Dukhari have captured and killed 1,000 imperial martyrs and distilled their souls into something, you know. So, this is, like, profane alien technology. But you know, it does contain the souls of 1,000 loyal servants of the emperor. But he's trying to think of like Pathfinder said, the gift for the imperial saint that has everything is just allowing 1,000 imperial martyrs their eternal rest rather than being trapped and tortured by alien forces.
Is that something that I would be interested in, like as like someone who represents the ecclesiarchy? Because to Dawn, like to me as a player, it's just like I don't know, like I'm not entirely
so from the, I'm sure if Dawn had it in her hand, she would smash it to release the souls, you know, because they are, yeah, they were good and faithful servants of the emperor apparently. I mean, I don't know if you've got any evidence that they're actually imperial martyrs or it's just a jar of dirt, but
sure, yeah. He's standing in front of you going, I've got a jar of dirt.
Yeah. I mean,
the other thing is he wants you to sell yourself into slavery with him as the price.
No, he doesn't. He just wants some blood.
Oh, so, well, I mean, that's actually really bad. I mean, what's he going to distill it into?
Yeah, I mean, you have no idea what a Drakari homunculus could do with a pint of your blood.
Yeah,
I mean, but it's always the heart of a judge of a Adeptus Arbiter in order to create a potion of resolve, right? Like, from a living saint, it's probably going to be pretty fucking powerful.
Those men and women that martyred themselves on behalf of the God Emperor, those are souls that have already paid their dues. I would very much like to get them back. However, what you're asking for in exchange is... the scales are not even.
So it's
not by a long shot.
There is a deal to be made here. It's purely a question of price. Well, I mean, I'm sure that you have spilled your own blood on many of the battlefields, but I understand if one pint seems like too much, I could probably reduce my requirement to a single quart.
That's more. That's more.
I thought a quart was a quarter pint. Sorry, no. Okay.
No. A quart is a quarter of a gallon.
Oh, sorry, my mistake.
So, okay. A little over 2 liters.
Okay.
Fill up this oil barrel for me, Dom. Dun.
All right. Well, anyway, he'll cut it down to, like, you know, what I don't drink. So I don't go. Well, pint's about a liter, isn't it? So, he's probably.
You could convert it to milliliters if you'd like.
Yeah. So let's say it'll take about 250 mils then.
See, that's the other thing. Like, what do I know about blood? Like, and I'm happy to make a roll here because for me as Dawn, I like the whole stigmata stuff is like really big in religion. So I don't know how much of a thing that plays in the ecclesiarchy, but
it's a tough one. I mean, nothing scientifically says that the blood does anything, but the church does certainly, you know, where things have been stained by the blood of a saint, for example, those things would be considered relics, but they don't have any intrinsic power. They're just focal points for faith, you know, so you put the relic in the church and the people that come to pray there, you know, believe that their prayers are being answered because the saint's blood-stained smock is in the church as such, but you can't, you know, the Imperium can't use blood for any sort of function beyond as a focal point for faith. It doesn't do anything that blood doesn't do scientifically for the Imperium. Right. Once you take out the retcon of the Grey Knight stuff.
So what about like forbidden law stuff? Am I expecting one day I'll wake up and I'll just be like 900 years older or something like that from him?
You can roll Forbidden Law Xenos. I know you've got that.
I have that as well.
2.7. It's pretty good. What did I roll there? 23. Yeah, okay.
Okay, so this guy is a homunculus, which means that his interest is, for the most part, scientific. So when he said he wants to study the blood, whether or not you trust him or not, like most of his kind, most homunculi, that's what they want to do. They want to pull it apart and understand what makes it work. They're not looking to use it for anything other than knowledge. If he was like an archon, like I say, therefore he was a member of not a homunculus, but he was like a member of a cabal, then maybe the use for like blood magic will be more likely. But this guy is probably more inclined just to, you know, he's more interested in what chemicals make up your blood than what it can do for him.
So I'm going to pull the Lord Captain to a sidebar real quick.
Yeah.
I'm going to say, I'm probably going to do this deal. You should get more out of it for yourself, though. Whatever it is that you want. The living saint blood probably is worth a lot. Not to me. I spill it all the time. And I'm about to spill it here in this vicinity when I fight whoever it is that this lady brings. So you might as well capitalize while you can.
How much are you willing to give? That's the question. Because obviously, if you give too much, you might not be at full combat strength by the time the person gets here.
Is there any negatives to me giving 250 mils, James?
No, no, it's a statistically negligible amount.
Then I, yeah, so just 250 mils. But I'm sure you can play up the sensitivity nature of my blood being.
Yeah, you might want a sandwich afterwards just to be, just so you keep the protein up.
Donut and a glass of oranges.
I'm trying to think, what would a homunculi have to offer Pierre at the moment?
Yo, can you give me an arm that constantly scratches my back?
Right, yeah, just you'd probably be alive too, knowing.
You guys are negotiating with Abathur and thinking that this is a good idea. All right.
Well, I mean, look, Dawn's motivation in this regard is literally 1,000 souls that she can free. So.
So, James, will there be any like other? Do homunculi just collect things, or are they just solely?
Yeah, they do have a they do certainly have a penchant for collection
of just like humanoid body parts and stuff, or
everything. Other... You know, first and foremost, they're scientists. So,
okay, that's just trying to figure out my knowledge on Drakari is very. Limited as
yeah, mine too, man. Don't worry about it.
Okay, I could see if he might have something that I might be interested in.
You do that like nod.
Yeah, I do. Yeah. I do the ready break in the huddle.
He taking a moment to Drakaris to take a moment to go and greet some other guests, but he turns back to you once it's clear that you've finished your huddle.
Dawn's willing to accept the deal, except we just might want a little bit more. Something else maybe you might have as far as your collection goes, some sort of maybe valuable weapons or technology that you might have with the Imperium.
I don't have anything else that would interest Sister Dawn the Tanya Living Saint, I don't think. But I noticed your Witchblade. Are you a collector of Eldari artifacts?
Andrew Kyron has the Witchblade.
Oh, sorry, I know it's your friend. Sorry, your friend's Witchblade, sorry.
Yeah, I got it, yeah.
Yeah.
Relatively speaking, I like to pick knickknacks and things on trips around the galaxies.
Oh, I have collected the crystallized agony of Farseer and Wraith in a debased spirit stone.
Farseer and Wraith.
You've never heard of this person before.
Oh, okay. That's... I know what a Farseer is.
Yeah.
But shove his soul into another racer. Interesting.
I have the captured final breath of the Archduke Tremere of the Homo ceramic file.
Archduke Tremere?
Give me a scholastic little history. Have you got that one at all?
I think I have legend. Let me look at my list of things. Yeah, I do have classical or legend. Yeah. Do that. 3.8 degrees, sec 2 on that roll.
Yeah,
my goodness.
So once again, not a saint, but one of the many sort of notable heroes who fought alongside Sandrasus during the liberation of the Calixa sector.
Like he has the literal last breath?
Yes.
I don't know what value last breath would be. This is just to open up and see what word he said at the end.
What do you have for lunch? I mean, it is like, as Smooth said, it's literally bric-a-brac. It's a garage sale of depravity.
I've also got a mint condition Nintendo 64.
It's basically like me going like, hey, I've got this like Clan Wolf pin over on my desk. Like, you want that?
Yeah.
Like, I've got this lint roller.
Let me remind you that this guy
famous
is,
person used it once.
He's Zagar Cool's second in command. There's got to be something from that perspective that would be valuable to us, not whatever he has in his pockets.
So there's, while you think about this, then a device in the area lights up and a hololith display generates a large three-dimensional image of a Trakari Archon in full resplendent armor. And everyone sort of turns and looks that way. And this holo display says, my friends, I welcome you to, He says this in Eldari language, who someone translates for you, basically. What he's saying, my friends.
I appear next to everybody and translate it.
I mean, I understand, fine.
I welcome you to my home. I apologize that I could not join you. I have recently survived another assassination attempt. And thankfully, this time I learned who the perpetrators were. And suddenly, like three people that are at the party who've just been like eating and drinking suddenly start to like, you know, cough and choke, and like blood starts to, you know, come out of their eyes and their ears as they sort of like grasp at their servants for help. Thankfully, matters have been taken care of. I promise the next time I will find a way to join you. But in the meantime, I leave you in the care of my servants, of Takaris. Any arrangements you would need to make with me, I would encourage you to make with them, and they will be fed back to me. Otherwise, please enjoy the festivities, enjoy the meal, and I will see you at the next gathering. And like, servants come and remove the bodies from the three dead Drakari.
Like in the vision?
No. This is not a vision. They were at the party.
People at the party just died.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
Yeah. Arthur, give me a Sunnisians roll at minus 20.
Okay. This is the thing I've already failed, just for the folks at home.
Hey, you passed last time.
Forbidden lore. Okay, yeah. Anyway. Yeah,
you pass the mic 20. Okay, so at the moment those three Drakari die as well, you still get that sense of something being drawn out of them by whatever this force is. Like, even though they don't have souls the way that you recognize it, there's still some element of them that can be sucked out by whatever this device is. It's just lesser.
Yeah. I lean in next to the captain and explain to him what just happened.
So Drakara says back to you, I apologize that my master cannot be here in person.
That's fine. I'm sure we'll meet him later. As for the deal, if it would be no trouble, I would take the soul of the Farseer, if that's no issue. And I'd like to have a time to be arranged where I can meet the man's champion, essentially.
So, you wish to meet Talon Baelwing, the champion of Zagar Cool?
Yes.
Interesting.
I'd like to meet too, if you can arrange it. That'd be really cool.
I can't make that deal right now. I'll have to confer with the Archon. But if that is possible, then we have an accord, then the blood for the meat, meeting the crystallized agony, and the vial of distilled souls.
Yes.
All right. He two of his like mechanical hands like pull out like a sheet of vellum, and just like jot down the details of the of like the proposed deal. Like it's not a contract, it's simply just like recognizing that this is what's been proposed, and they like write out two copies and hand you one.
In flesh, I'm guessing.
No, it's film. It's like some sort of parchment.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. It's not that bad. Come on.
Yeah, I never know.
He walks over to the corpse and rips off some of the thigh.
I mean, he might be the more tame ones. I don't know. There could be crazier ones.
How long do we have to wait before you get us confirmation?
I only ask
because there's some succubus lady who's bringing her champion over here for stupid reasons.
I see. Well, given that my master cannot join the party, I really shouldn't leave the party until it's done. Is it something that we can handle after this the fair here is completed?
Absolutely. Should be an issue at all.
Very well. Well, please enjoy the party and good luck, Sister Dawn the Tanya Living Saint, in whatever it is you have struck with Anyara.
I'm sure it'll be very eventful.
Well, he goes back to entertaining the various people. Did you want to, so before I move on to the scene with Aliyah, did anyone want to have any conversation among your own group first off?
Yeah, as he leaves, I'll turn to Adrian, and I'll say, not Adrian, sorry, fuck, it's been a while.
Yeah.
Andrew Kyron. Jesus Christ. Yeah. And did I hear you whisper something about souls?
Yes.
Or something?
Okay. Is that something you need to know?
Well, I just purchased 1,000 of them for some blood, and I'm going to set them free, but if I can't set them free, perhaps I should wait.
I suspect that it would be better to set them free when we are in real space rather than this realm.
You make a good point. Very well. Thank you for finding this out. How did you know, by the way?
About what?
The souls not being
this
able to
place
be...
is sucking souls into the ziggurat. I suppose you could say the souls are being reaved.
Ah! Man, this is like the second or third time in the show that he's done that.
Right. Second time.
I'll
allow it twice.
I am
the third time he dies.
Struck down in his prime. What a shame.
I am ever pleased to be at your service, Living Saint.
So you're able to see these souls for what they are?
Do you have the object with you?
I do not, but is there a way that you can verify that they are in fact souls of the Imperium?
I can verify that they are souls. I cannot verify that they are martyrs. Not without twisted experimentation.
Well, and releasing them in normal space won't have any problems for us.
They should continue the natural arc of their life.
Great. Fantastic. Even if they're not all Imperium martyrs, it won't. Nothing bad will befall us. So, I can't leave the threat of eternal damnation on my shoulders like them.
Did you need me for anything else, Livingstone?
You didn't eat that food that those gentlemen ate, did you?
I don't think our biology is suited to eat the food of this particular place.
I say that, you just somehow remind me of a man who used to do that constantly, so...
void eels.
I got them all, bro. I got every single one. That's Pokemon.
I remember that episode.
Yeah, terrible diarrhea for days.
It's not even close to what happened.
Yeah. I know. I know what happened. I was there.
All right. I'm going to go stand next to Adrian looking very uncomfortable and just say, Master Thorn.
Yes, Sandra Cairo.
I am at a loss.
Oh.
And then I'm going to look at the captain and Dawn and motion for the two of us to move a little further away from them.
He'll follow you.
Okay. As you may know, I have been chronicling the actions of the living saint Don Latenya for posthumous consumption. Or pre-posthumous consumption, I suppose, since she will outlive us all.
Indeed.
I am uncertain if any part of our adventures here should be included in the canticles. It feels wrong to remove them, but it feels equally wrong to venerate a saint while also dealing with Xenos, a traditionally forbidden art. Indeed, it could drive some to heresy to even read these articles.
You make an excellent point. I believe that perhaps we should wait until we have completed our mission here to decide what story will be told in the official writings.
I look around at the ziggurat and I say, I had believed that this would be a very simple and straightforward mission. That was foolish. I doubt we will get out of this one with the same kind of luck and lack of losses we have seen in the past. And I say that knowing that we walked away from a full attack of daemons from She Who Thirsts with a nuclear-powered Titan.
These problems are less straightforward than the ones we've dealt with previously.
Our very souls are at risk of damnation here from at least three different ways.
I
do not know that if Don dies here, either in this place or in this particular structure, if she will continue her journey. Her existence may be at the gravest level of threat. Placing her in the arena may be akin to removing the Emperor's Queen off of the chessboard. God Emperor's. The God Emperor's High Lord of Terra off of the dark chessboard of the grim future.
Do you see a route to accomplish our goals without putting the saint at risk?
No. I'm concerned that her presence here may lead to her demise and damnation. But I need more time to think. This place is wrong.
Well, it's full of Xenos. Of course it is.
Anyway, here, take this.
What do you hand him?
It's a pamphlet brochure of like the canticles of the living saint Don Latenya, articling her deeds, and includes, you know, a passage, the words of her first follower, Master Adrian Quintus Thorn. It's like, I was amazed that day. My eyes were widened. Possible thing said by Master Thorn.
Yeah. quote may be attributed to. Yes.
So the whole thing is a mix of actual historical events over five pages and a combination of like circus, carnival, like what could it be? Like charlatanerism.
All right. So, and Niara returns to the party with another Dracari woman in tow, who's unbelievably is wearing less than she is because she's wearing like just a regular witch suit. And then also a couple of servants carrying like a couple of large, like sealed crates. And you know, people start sort of clearing out of the way to create room for a sort of circle of equals almost. When the crates get put down, they open up to reveal all manner of different melee weapons. You know, some standard, like, you know, mono swords, axes, etc. Other more exotic Eldari weapons. Along with a variety of chemical concoctions, like, you know, sort of like drug injectors and the like. Sorry, I've got a child in the room getting paper from the printer. And Aniara comes over to Dawn once more. So you still wish to fight my champion? Yvanil?
Yvanil, sorry. Significant PC glance, aka the full-on eyebrow. Is this something we still want? Question mark. Dot eyebrow.
I mean, look, if you can beat these people, it's no problem. It's just that Andra Kyron is worried that if you lose, you're going to get Shao Kahn'd, right? Sigar Kul is going to show up and go, your soul is mine!
No, technicality. Yeah.
I mean, there's no technicality.
I've never seen that finishing move before.
There's no.
There's a lot of them now, though.
That's the technicality.
It's going to be a fatality, and you're going to get rocked.
Sorry, Dave.
What was she wearing? You said she was wearing less than.
Well, it's a witch suit. So if you just like, you know, if you were to Google Dark Eldar Witch, WYCH, you can see the sort of stuff that they wear. It's not a lot, though. It's like it's not really armor. Like it does mechanically give 2 points of armor, but literally an armored body glove gives more armor than that.
Okay, I mean I'm wearing my rosary and my nunnery, right? So I'm not exactly in power armor either. So I guess this is a.
Are we getting your power armor? I'm confused.
We are, well, but I am.
So you're at a party inside, like the ziggurat. Like, you don't really have the opportunity to set a runner, or if they do, they might come back and get stopped by the guards, and they have invitations. But certainly the implication here from Rand Rally and Yara is that, you know, I've bought a selection of gladiatorial weapons and armor. You know, I invite you to, you know, to choose something from this selection.
Well, I mean, I have my sword. Am I not allowed to use it? Is that the implication here?
Well, if you bring this up with her, I saw Nara, so she's like, well, is this a contest to prove who is the better fighter or who has the bigger budget?
Dawn like cracks her neck and she's like, okay, we're getting snappy. Fine. Let me take a look at the shit you've brought.
So most of the weapons that are here are things that you're not, like the witch weapons you're not trained with. You would be using them at a disadvantage. But they do have things like conventional mono swords. There's probably like an Eldari chainsword that you could use without penalty because it functions just like a regular chainsword. Mm-hmm. Certainly no power weapons.
Right.
Okay. You know, but so any sort of conventional primitive weapon, mono edge, so that it's no longer primitive. Mm-hmm. Or a chainsword is probably the extent of the most advanced weapon that you could use.
Yeah, I'm familiar with chainswords. I even have one on my character sheet that I haven't used in a very long time.
It's been a while.
You got your new badass. Well, you got a burning blade, then a regular power sword. Then you got your
badass. The implication is that they're like, these are the weapons you can use in the gladiatorial arena. You can't use your own shit, so have to pick and choose from what they have. So, you know, Dawn will, you know, look over the crates mostly in disgust, right? Like, she sees all these witch weapons. She's just like, ugh, nasty. Fucking witch cooties, you know? But then she'll pick out, like, a chainsaw.
Okay. And
she'll swing it around, you know, trying to feel out its balance or whatever. And if she's satisfied with it, she'll, you know... standing at the ready.
It's actually remarkably well made, and you know, despite what you're used to, the motor on it's actually quite quiet. So you know, you're used to like chainsaws like sounding like a chainsaw whenever you rev them, you know. So this one is lighter, better made, and quieter as well. Like not certainly not stealthy, just you know, it would.
You know, that sounds like that would make it not as enjoyable, honestly.
Let me think. Would she know? I'm going to make a roll for Anyara to see if she knows this.
Is it a scorpion chainsword?
Sorry? No. Yeah, it looks like a scorpion chainsword, yes.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so she, points to your Rosarius.
Mm-hmm.
You have a field. I could accept this, provided my fighter can also wear one. Would you prefer to fight with or without fields?
What is her field? Can I see it?
Without actually asking
to see it, but can I?
Yeah, no, it's yeah. So she hands some device to the Blood Bride, who activates it, and it's more like a displacer field. Like it creates like mirror images. So rather than making it so it just deflects hits, it makes her harder to hit, but it has no actual protective quality. So whereas your field might just cancel a hit, this one turns away the hit in the first place.
Okay. I'm fine with it. I mean, mine has the brightness effect to it as well. So.
Yeah, because yours is a conversion field. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So cool. I'm cool with that. Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. No worries.
So what are the rules then?
Okay. So the rules of the match?
I assume so.
Yes. The survivor will become the new champion. Also, will become the contender for the championship.
Okay, so it is to the death. And if she taps out?
If either opponent can withdraw, but trust me, Innerville will not be withdrawing.
We'll see.
If she did, I would kill her myself.
Oh, okay then.
So I think that we can do this this death match after the break.
Is that what she says to everyone?
Yeah, that's right. All right. Everybody, go get some drinks. Come back here in 8 minutes for the death match.
We have to line up the plastic sheeting and everything on the ground.
Yeah. Yeah, they need time to play some bets.